Keeping up with our motto, let learning be a joy and teaching a pleasure. Here we are with the remote teaching and a learning process to bridge the gap. Happy learning, students. Hello, students. I, Ms. Radhika Yadav, teaching at Thakur Vidya Mandir High School and Junior College, once again here with you, dealing with subject history of Standard 7, Chapter 4, Maharashtra before the times of Shivaji Maharaj. So at the beginning of the 17th century CE, most of the territory in Maharashtra was under the control of Nizam Shah of Ahmednagar and Adil Shah of Bijapur. So students, that was in the beginning of the 17th century. Now what happened that all this territory in the Maharashtra was under the Adil Shah and Nizam Shah. So these two powers which were formed after the disintegration of Bahamani Kingdom. Now this we have already learned in our second chapter. The Bahamani power disintegrated into five powers, and these two powers, that is Adil Shah and Nizam Shah, were two powers of the Bahamani Kingdom. So these two powers had a control over most of the territory of Maharashtra in the beginning of the 17th century. The Mughals had entered Khandesh. Their objective was to expand their power in the south. There were settlements of Siddhi people who had come from Africa along the coastline of Konkan. So it was not only the Adil Shah and Nizam Shah, but also the Mughals and Siddhi people who had come from Africa tried to expand their power in the South Maharashtra. The competition and conflict amongst the Portuguese, the British, the French and the Dutch who had come from Europe was getting intense during this period, because there was a stiff competition amongst them to capture the markets for the trade. So the Portuguese, who had already established their rule in Goa and Vasai on the western coastline, the British, the Dutch and the French had found an entry through the medium of trading companies by setting up factories. So all these powers assessed the strength of other powers, kept themselves safe and tried to dominate as much as possible. And this conflict had created instability and insecurity in Maharashtra. So these different people from Europe were called Topkar on the basis of their customary headgear. Now students, why it is necessary to get acquainted with the village, kasba and pargana? So it is necessary to get acquainted because we need to understand the nature of settlements in that period, as also of the officers that formed a link between the rulers and their subjects, and also the markets and the craftsmen. Pargana was made up of many villages. Generally, the headquarters of a pargana was called kasba. A village smaller than a kasba was called mauja. So students, let us acquainted in brief with village, kasba and pargana respectively. So here you can see the image of village, that is mauja. Now what is village? Most of the people lived in the villages, and village was also called as mauja. The chief of the village was the patil. So he means the patil. They tried to bring maximum land under the cultivation, and when there was any dispute in the village, the patil resolved it and made peace. A Kulkarni helped the patil in his work, and the Kulkarni kept the record of the revenue that was collected. And there were various artisans in the village. They had hereditary rights regarding their occupation, and the peasants gave a share of their agricultural produce to the artisans for the service they rendered to the village community. And this share was known as baluta. Baluta, as we know, that it is just an exchange of goods or a commodity, that is called as baluta. So here, as they were giving their land for the cultivation, in return they used to give a agricultural produce to the landowners, that is called as baluta. Now next we have is Kasba. So students, Kasba is just like a big village. So here you can see the image of Kasba, how it was. So as I said, Kasba is a big village. It is usually the headquarters of a Pargana. For example, Indapur Kasba of Indapur Pargana, Y Kasba of Y Pargana, they were the headquarters of those Parganas, and agriculture was the main occupation at that time, and there were skilled artisans like carpenters, blacksmiths, etc. in a Kasba. So there was usually a market which is called Pet adjacent to a Kasba. The Seth and Mahajans were the Vatandars of the Pet. Every village did not necessarily have a Pet. So the setting up of a Pet was the job of the Seths and Mahajans. For example, and for that they received some land from the government and some rights from the villagers, and the Mahajans maintained the accounts of the Pet. Now students, what is Vatandar? Now Vatandar is it's an Arabic word, and in Maharashtra it is used, is referred to hereditary land for which the holder does not have to pay revenue. That is called as Vatandar. So next we have is Pargana. Now let's see what is Pargana is. So Pargana is basically like many villages which comes together and forms a Pargana, but the number of villages was not the same in all Parganas. For example, the Pune Pargana was a big Pargana. It consisted of 290 villages. There were 64 villages in the Chakan Pargana, and the Shirwal Pargana was the smallest one. It had only 40 villages. The Deshmukh and the Deshpande were the Vatandars officers of the Pargana, and the Deshmukh was the chief of the Patils in Pargana. And the Deshmukh did at the Pargana level what the Patil did at the village level. The Deshpande was the chief of all Kulkarnis in the Pargana, and the Deshpande did at the Pargana level the work that Kulkarnis did at the village level. And these Vatandas officers were the link between the people and the government. In case of enemy invasion or drought, these Vatandas represented the grievances of the people to the government. So sometimes what happened that these officers misused their power, they misused their authority. So they collected more money from the people than it was due, or did not remit the money, so collected the government in time. On such occasions, the people suffered harassment. Thank you, students.
Thank you. The first